Well, the new record we're working on is the first one we've done in, geez, like 4 or 5 years, probably. Everybody always wants to do something fresh and different, especially when you've been doing it for so long. And everybody always looks for that, you know, how to think outside the box and stuff. And we're the same. That's what we want to do, too.
I mean, I have to say that I've definitely entered the most prolific point in my life since college, where I used to be able to write, you know, 5 songs a day.
Good morning.
I've been able to experience this great rebirth of my creative spirit, and so I just feel renewed. We're gonna just try something different. We're gonna work with some new people. Great. I'm excited about it. Again?
Yeah.
That's cool.
Yeah, the bridge.
Yeah, it's really good.
Okay. Yeah, that's nice.
Okay, sweet. From the top again? Oops.
Subject.
a soft landing. It's not like snap, you know, like, So it makes it not like jazz hands, you know, it makes it like.
Yeah, we don't want jazz hands.
Yeah, it feels like it eases into it. There's a little parachute on it. I like it.
Parachute.
What if I played this on stage like this? How I came to work on this. If you find out, let me know. I mean, like, Jordan, I sort of known her on our periphery, like our social and musical periphery for a long time, and the last time we made a record, she has all these great instruments, and she loaned us a bunch of instruments, and it was kind of like, she was always very quiet and respectful, so I never knew her as a person.
A while back, we started talking about producers, and we had talked to Peter Collins, a friend of ours who's produced a lot of our records, and he was like, you guys feel free to work with somebody new, because we were going to work with him. And it made us start thinking a little bit about, well, maybe we should, like, you know, do something different.
And then she produced Lucy Wainwright Roach's latest record, and she's great friends with Lucy, and we're great friends with Lucy. We loved the production that Jordan did for Lucy, and Amy, who always has a great idea, was like, well, why don't we see if Jordan wants to produce it?
I don't have 50 records under my belt, and I'm not, you know, I don't know, I don't have as much experience, or, like, I'm young, and I'm a woman, and there are all these things where it's like, okay, this is a bold choice. And Amy was like, that's not that bold, I got a good instincts. I was like, okay, well.
Like, what I think a good producer does is bring out something new in an artist that you haven't heard before, or bring out the core of the songs in a way that they're not able to do themselves, you know? And I thought Jordan did that with Lucy, so in the back of my mind, ever since I'd heard that record, I was like, wow, I secretly want to work with her.
I love working with Jordan. She's talented, she has a vision. She works hard. She's nice. She's an awesome person. I mean, it was just the right fit.
I feel like I'm gonna barf.
Why?
I don't know.
Like, physically ill?
Yeah.
Well, that sushi should settle your stomach nicely.
Okay, I'm right here today. When I got it this morning, the van wasn't starting. Like, charged the battery yesterday and was making sure it was working and everything. Loaded all the gear up. It was fine. Got up this morning, 6:30 a.m. or something. Anyway, I went out there right before I was supposed to leave. No starty. So then I ran, got jumper cables, tried to run a car for about 30 minutes to charge it up.
Oh, shit.
Wouldn't work. Had to go buy a battery. Had to put the battery in the car. And then drive to Nashville.
God.
I'm tired.
Well, no wonder you feel like crap.
Oh, she had a hard night.
Oh, it was probably Brady. Or, it was Sam, the guy from the engineer.
Yeah, let's do this.
All right.
I hate this song.
You hate this song?
I hate this song.
I hate this song.
I like this song.
Or don't even say key.
Happy in the sorrow. That's what I do before the instrumental starts, though. Maybe I don't do that before the instrumental starts. Maybe before the instrumental starts, I actually resolve it. Instead of going to that D.
Or maybe you do it both times and you get like, you know, one time you get like, oh, here's a nice little D, and maybe I'm gonna get that again. No, you're not, you're gonna get this. You know?
Nope, don't say key.
Yeah, I like it being a big, big band hit.
Happy in the sorrow. Like it. Let's do it. Happy in the sorrow key is kind of like this. It's like something I started quite a long time ago, and another song that I finished after my dad passed away, because I was thinking, I had read Joan Didion's book for like the umpteenth time about dying and losing her husband and stuff, and she used a lot of like language in it that translated for me really well to like something I was already writing, and so it kind of was a catalyst for me to finish a song. It's not about death, but it's about impermanence. It's kind of the opposite of ignorance is bliss. It's like me saying, you know, I'm happier when I know the facts, and when I know the pain, and when I know all the sorrow in life, and when I am faced with things, even though I'm not really, like, I'm really kind of bummed by it, but it's my affirmation of, like, being, trying to be a badass and saying, like, you know, screw everything, I'm happy being sad. As I lay my burden down now, in the cradle of an elegy, in the shotgun shape of this life, sorrow keep. Ben, you sound so good. As I lay my burden down now, it's better without it.
Yep, I agree.
Good experiment. Slapback's better. Just the slapback alone does it for me.
Okay, that tambourine was awesome. No claps on this. We don't want claps. Who wants claps? I do. How about some claps?
What do you want?
Happy in the sorrow that part.
Start it.
This is my favorite part of making a record, though. When you start to put the fun stuff on it. You
know? Yeah, because that's like, when you get to be really creative and get kind of wacky, I think.
Yeah, totally. And
you're
you get
done
happy
with the
mistakes.
Job part.
Yeah, you're done with the job part.
Mm-hmm. And usually this is when I go home and say, I'm done. My vocal's done. No compy.
You don't stay for the fun part?
No.
Amy
God,
can
I'm
sing
kidding.
Live.
All
I can't.
Business. Grouch.
Grouch.
Grouch number one.
Natural balance,
Brenda. Terrible balance.
So we're going to stand around that mic for one pass and then stand around this mic for the other pass.
I'm practicing.
Oops, sorry guys.
I'm not so sure.
Iggy, you'll have to just cut that off where it cuts off.
I think we're good.
We can't even make us. This is definitely not Atlanta, Georgia.
We always have some good laughs, but nothing like this. I mean, this is like your stomach hurts and you have to go to the bathroom, you laugh so hard. And then you go home and you think about what happened and you laugh some more. And it's just everything is just right at the right point right now in time, you know, for all of this.
Happy in the sorrow key.
Went to high school at Shamrock in Atlanta. Went to elementary school together. And then I went to my first year at Vanderbilt and she went to her first 2 years at Tulane, and then we both transferred back to Emory.
I think I probably would have been an English teacher. In fact, I was preparing for grad school while Amy and I were a bar band and sort of, you know, sitting on the fence, and then she was doing all the work at that time, and one day she said, you know, do you want to go to grad school or do you want to do this? We already had a little career going. She was nice about it. I'm sure she was frustrated hanging up all the posters.
I mean, she did some work. She did a little work.
Yeah.
But, like, I was kind of the business person, go-getter. I was really, like, into it and determined to make it work, and I think she could take it or leave it a little bit. She had fun. And she was like, it's fun.
Yeah.
You know, but it wasn't like, it's fun and let's work really hard. You know what I mean?
We're so different. I mean, really, our personalities are night and day. We took one of those, what's it called? Enneagrams, where you do the numbers and you find out what your numbers are. And we were at the exact opposite poles.
which I, you know, we expect it to be. But our values are the same. Our commitment to social justice issues and things like that. And so it's just turned out to be a remarkable relationship.
Every time you get a vocal right, Emily, you can have half of a cookie.
They're so different and just really opposite. And so there's something about it that it feels like melding two metals together that shouldn't necessarily go together. And you meld them together and they become this other and this thing that is couldn't exist without the other one. And the songs that, when it does that, that to me sounds like the thing. When it's like, oh man, that is magical.
Jordan herself will play probably a lot of stuff. Like, because she created, when we started the whole process, she created these things that she called frames. And would like take our demos and then create a whole like soundscape around them to kind of show us the vibe that she had in mind for the song. And it was an awesome process because it really helped us visualize the direction of the record.
She just came up with these sort of musical landscapes that early on she put onto our very, very rough demos, and then she sent them to us and we absorbed them, and it was like, oh, this is great, this is great.
And that was like at the very beginning of our process. And then we kind of just went from there. But Jordan will end up playing some horns and some guitars and keys and just a few things like sprinkled like fairy dust over everything.
I think I'm generally attracted to sounds that you can't necessarily place, and I'm not afraid to do some weird shit.
Jordan, we talked about that humming or singing over the top of a string part.
Totally.
I think Alberta would be suited to
okay.
that.
Right,
can you play something purdy?
Give it a try.
Oh, cool.
All right. What day is it? Thursday?
Yeah. Tomorrow maybe?
Maybe. Pass. I switched some stuff around.
There's a lot of kind of layers where it creates kind of like willow branches hanging down where you kind of are in the scene but not acutely, we can't see and everything at the same time. Part of that sound, I think, is it's a little more like painting.
Ooh, that's nice. Just in the links is nice.
Totally.
Not in the verses, maybe. The bowed parts? Don't be mad. Hey, mister. My lights ain't dimming.
Try the big one. I have nothing to do with that.
Oh.
Shit.
Well, can you see anything there?
I'll come over to the other side and see what I can get. I'll push it. It'll just be grainy. I guess it'll just be snippets anyway.
Ooh, Alberta. Seems like a long time, but it's been no time in the course of a lifetime since you've gone. The crack in the window, is that how you got through? Dog's howl, is that you? A setting sun. You took a wild rose from a bird. Upon this yellow page,
I think what we are always trying to capture is like the core of what is important about us, like Indigo Girls for us. And we keep coming back to like, we gotta work on harmonies more and really make sure we're focusing on our harmonies and really work on the arrangements and have really like a solid sort of duo approach to things before we start just throwing stuff on it.
Bottom line is that whoever wrote the song gets ultimate control over it. So you'll notice in the studio that when we're working on one of Amy's songs, Amy's sitting at the table scrutinizing, you know, every little thing. It's her song. She has a more intimate relationship with it. But we give ideas to each other. We bounce off ideas. But, you know, that so we have a really strong understanding and working relationship.
And I'm not playing guitar on this song anyway.
What are you doing?
This was the one that I was going to try to play dulcimer on, yeah. But I don't know how to play dulcimer yet.
I'll figure it out by the end of the session.
Just learn that. I brought one with me, though. It's in the van. I'm going to practice it at 1 a.m.
I didn't have a car, but I did have a guitar. And I played to my advantage when you lived.
Things happened to us where I was at like the Americana Music Festival and Brady Blade was there and we hadn't asked him to play on the record yet. This was only like a few weeks ago. And I was like, Brady, it's so great to see you. And then I'm like, do you want to play on our record? Because I love, he's like one of my favorite drummers of all time.
It's nasty.
Good. Is that an old school beat or what
yeah,
is it?
Yeah, kind of. I'm doing a mixture of like old Royal Studios, Memphis
yeah.
with Tom Petty.
Great. The only part I wasn't sure about, Brady, was when you went to the Tom Field.
Yeah, I was just trying something out, and it got a little busy. I think I should save that for only one small little section or something.
Okay.
Difference. You know, I went a little bit too long, got a little too happy. But when y'all start singing the harmonies, this shit be fucking me up. So, yeah. I'd be like, hey, you know, I get it every time. Kills me every time.
And then we just
14 years I've been doing y'all. Still killing
oh,
me.
Oh, they're going to harmonize again, aren't they? Oh!
Love choosing players that are just perfectly suited for the thing you want, because I'm a side person myself, and it's such a great feeling to be like let loose on something.
It's exciting to work with new musicians, and I usually And typically when we work with someone new, we know like how great they are and stuff. So we're not scared, like, are they going to be good enough for something like that?
We had never worked with Fred or Butterfly before.
Jordan saw Fred somewhere in town because the other drummer we were going to work with besides Brady didn't end up being available. And she was just like, hey, do you want to work on this project? So he was like, yeah. So that kind of happened. And then we were sitting around and Jordan was like, do you think Butterfly Boucher could come play some bass? And I was like, sure. So there were like a lot of like informal sort of ideas thrown around. And it ended up being totally amazing.
What it is with musicians, like if you pick the ones that you know can go there with you in a song, then, you know, 9 times out of 10, they just do. It just seems like, oh, this is the only bass part that could be on this song, and this is the only drum part that could be on this song, and because those gifted musicians bring the song to life. Findlay, you know, Findlay is just kind of a creepy song. Part of it is from my life. We used to go visit my grandma. We called her Grammy, and she lived in Findlay, and my mom was born in Findlay. And a lot of the images in that song are true. It's about the terrible things that can happen in childhood that kids don't understand, and there's like a collision of innocence and loss of innocence, and then there was all the political upheaval of that time, you know, with Kent State about to happen. And so for some reason, just when I was writing a batch of songs, I landed on that. I started playing this chord progression, and then it just made me think of that, which is kind of like the mystery of songwriting. You never know what's going to come down the pipe when you find a simple chord progression.
Findlay, Ohio, 1968, poking hot tar bulbs with a stick on the driveway. Grammy's a Republican, Nixon is her man.
Findlay, those guys, they just hadn't even really heard it much, and they just came in and they played what their spirits led them to play, and it's awesome.
Roger is the boy next door. He's a wanderer. He starts with his hand. Kathy's the
Carol Isaacs is just, she's an incredible keyboard player. She can create a whole landscape out of your song, like she did that in the past with, I'm thinking of the song Yoke in particular from our last record, one of Amy's songs. Or she can play, pick out two spooky notes like in Findlay.
She's always drinking beer.
Those are great notes.
Kathy's dad never came back.
Has.
I like the smell. Trash and leaves burning in the cans. Roger is the corner next door. He's a wanderer. He starts by holding my hands. Scared but curious. Raised upright but furious. What happened?
Scaling girl. Thanks, y'all.
Some of these songs really feel like emotionally charged, and some feel like soaring, like I've Come a Long Way, where you're looking back and you kind of, you know, there's so much gratitude I hear in it, and some you look back and kind of like make you shift in your seat a little bit and feel uncomfortable, like Finley. And there are extremes on this record where you kind of take the sentiment all the way. If it's moody, I want to be like rolling on the floor, crying into a bowl of ramen, like tears and noodles kind of, you know, going together. And if it's, you know, a party, I want to, you know, have like, I don't know, I was actually thinking period. I want to shake up a bottle and just like spray it everywhere. And Rise of the Black Messiah, for example, that feels like a raw, primal, really striking story that is not to be reckoned with kind of feeling. So as a result, it's like, oh, we got to track that live. And Amy loves doing that anyway. But it feels like there's no other way you could do that song than like all being in a room together and like just laying into everything.
This is gonna be rock. This is a rock song. I mean, I wanted my goal. I don't know if this is gonna happen. It sounds like Brady Blade's gonna make it happen. My goal is to get a completely live version of this, so where everybody's input is live, and that we just, it's not one of the songs that we're gonna like work on and craft and like produce in a certain way. We're just gonna like get it. That's what the goal is. We'll see what happens.
Oh, no, transitions.
Yeah, that's where it's weird.
So they did.
You hear that back?
Yeah, it's backing up just a little bit.
Yep. Can we try me singing Out There with the Drums on 57 with my mandolin plugged in?
Yeah.
And then we can reamp my mandolin through like a Princeton or something.
Yep.
Or I could take a direct, and no, it'll be in the room with hers, so that's not so good.
I'll hear it enough.
Okay, great.
I don't need to hear it. I don't need to hear myself. I'll hear enough.
Okay.
I'm gonna just try it. If it's a disaster, we'll know within 1 second. Five seconds, ten seconds.
We have all those. Yeah. We have so many seconds.
Roland?
Yes, sir?
They called you the Rise of the Black Messiah, like so many boys before you. And there'll be more to follow, threatening, hard to swallow. I'll sit underneath that hanging tree, just me and the ghost of the KKK. Poor man's gallows in the middle of the woods, the saddest tree that ever stood. That old Jim Crow, he just keeps getting barred with a new hanging rope for the black man's scourge. Old Man River, what do you know about a plantation they called Angola? Devil's found a prison there to satisfy.
There's a prison, a penitentiary in Louisiana called Angola, and it had been a plantation, and then it became a prison, and it was sort of run on the like a plantation model. And in the early 70s, these three black men, well, they were young men at the time, very young, were arrested, and I think it was New Orleans or around that area, and they were thrown into jail, and they ended up in Angola, and they were they were like all three kind of working on organizing the prisons for better conditions, because Angola was known as being extremely cruel and inhumane. A prison guard was murdered, and they were framed for the murder. I believe they were framed. And these guys were thrown into solitary confinement and remained there from that point on, which was like, at the time Herman wrote me a letter, was about 35 years at that point. He was writing musicians and artists and people in the world to say, will you talk about this and bring attention to it? And one of the things he said in the letter was, you know, when this happened and we were thrown into solitary and we were like, and the Black Panthers within the prison system were sort of tamped down, they said that they needed to prevent the rise of the Black Messiah, the CIA and the FBI.
Which one do you think?
I think that's a better ending, but I think the other take on the whole is better.
Do you want to know what I think?
Yeah, I do.
I think I like the back three blobs of this one. I think I like, what's the verse with Angola? I like Angola on the other one. I like verse 1-4 of the other one and the bridge out of this.
What about the beginning, though, of this one is a little bit more... the mandolin's a little bit more in tune, and it might sound... I mean, we could...
I don't mind the verse one. It's by the time you get to verse three, I need more energy that this one doesn't give me.
This one has a better bridge, though. Okay. Oh, great granddaddy, which is right around the Angola
thing. Yeah, I like the bridge of this one.
You can't cut back and forth, though, so we might just have to... Like, back and forth and back and forth. I mean, we could, but it would... I wouldn't...
It wouldn't, you know, like it
works. I just would, with this song, it's just an emotional thing. I just wanted to pick one performance. I know that we can do a bunch of different things, but it's just like it's a different animal than everything else on the record for me. Mm-hmm. I just wanted to pick like a complete thought.
Yeah, for sure.
But if you want to compromise, why don't we put the ending on the other one? Because I know you like this ending better. And I can be sold on that for sure.
Oh, shit.
Don, I think you're on the first gun. Oh, you're on the second gun rise.
Try that.
I know it's rough. Rise, yeah, he's gonna rise.
The bass might need a...
That sounds pretty damn good.
Yeah, how the fuck did he do
that? That's great.
I'll take it.
Seamless.
Let me see if I can...
I can let go of my spiritual idea for that.
There's a lot of spirit in there, though.
No, it's worth it. It's worth it for that moment. I loved that moment.
Yeah.
He's gonna rise. Think of the full circle. We made a mistake and it worked.
The full circle.
I feel like the record... Like, I feel like it's going super well, and it's sort of a more, probably a way more involved record than we, a long, long time ago, were envisioning, which was like we were just going to all get in one room and play a bunch of songs, and that was going to be it. I guess we've kind of gotten into this place where we've, like, created this thing, and we're not done with it yet, and I'm afraid we're not going to be able to finish in time, to be honest. But I don't really care, because we'll just extend what we have to extend to get it done, because I really do think it's, like... I really do think it's good, and I think it's better than, not better than, as good as anything we've done, and maybe even better, and definitely different. And so, I'm pretty excited about it. Yeah. I like that.
That's cool.
Yeah. I like. Do you like the two drum thingies?
Yeah.
I should probably do mine separately because I don't want to mess anybody up.
Or do you want to be a producer and sit in there? You can either be a musician and be cool like us, or you can sit on the other side of the window.
Why don't we try it this way? We have a listen, see how it feels.
Yeah.
Something novel idea, I know, but. I wake up excited to go into the studio. The most stressful part of recording is, the budget. No, just kidding. The most stressful part is getting the vocals done.
I think the thing that we have left to do is a lot, which is a lot of vocals, our vocals and our guitar stuff. And we typically don't leave that to the end. And so it's the opposite than how we do things. So that's a little bit, that makes us a little bit nervous.
Getting your vocal right when it's so personal and you even everybody in the room could be like, oh man, that vocal is awesome. And you could be like, no, it could be better. It could be different. And only the singer has that feeling about it.
I don't think we'll run out of time because I think if we need more time, we'll just make more time and mix it later or something. We'll have to adjust because we got to get the vocals done, which in a way was a smart way to do it because now it's like if the vocals are the thing that's left, we can't, you know, if what was left was like some trumpet overdubs, we might be like, let's skip them. But now that the vocals are the thing that's left, we have to do the vocals. And so that means that all the other goodies that we wanted to do got done. And we didn't have to, like, forego them.
What you gonna do with your idle hands?
I mean, that's sweet. What I heard.
Okay.
Just a straight...
Cool.
Yeah.
What you gonna do with your idle mind? What you gonna do with a king?
I jumped to the five. She could go to the third.
That's what I was kind of imagining, but... You don't have to.
What you're gonna do? Yeah.
We'll see which is better.
Oh, you know what a third is, don't you?
Well, no, I'm not sure.
Spread the Pain Around. I was another song that I wrote. I started a long time ago. Like, I mean, probably 10 years ago. And it was just this little ditty that I would just play every now and then on my mandolin and kind of almost a country song. So when I was trying to finish it, the thing that kind of the catalyst for me to sort of finish it in a way and look at the chorus in a different way and kind of think about this idea of voices kind of cascading over each other and harmonies and stuff. I was thinking about the Roaches, who were a big influence on us, and Suzzy Roach's daughter, Lucy Wainwright Roach, who we've known since she was 8. And we've just kept in touch with her mom, of course, and her over time, and she's like this great songwriter now and performer who tours with us sometimes. And I kept thinking about her voice and like, we're just, you know, she's got to be on this song. So she came through town and came to the studio.
Spread the pain around.
I mean, it's just in her. Like, she's part of, like, Loudon Wainwright and Suzzy Roach. It's like the music is emanating from her soul all the time. So I always know that we just have to put her in the studio and have her start singing, and it'll be great.
What you gonna do with your idle mind? What you gonna do with a keg of wine? Spread the pain around.
Hold on. We don't let anything go by, especially in terms of pitch. Like, if the harmonies aren't in pitch together, we'll re-sing it or fix it. You know, they just, because in the end, it's amazing to me the way when you tweak little details like that, the emotional experience of the song far surpasses what it would be if you didn't fix those things. We're just keen on getting them in tune and lined up right and stuff like that. There's a lot, I think people would be surprised at how meticulous the work is in the studio.
Keg of wine, spread the pain around.
Pitch could be better. One more.
Keg of wine, spread the pain around.
One more for me. I felt like I was losing it on the round and...
You know, it's got to be a visceral reaction. You can't go, well, maybe this is the good part. I don't know. You know, it has to be like, this is it. And until it's it, it's not done.
Understand. Cause you don't wanna write that song where you done her wrong. She can't take you back. One where she just can't forgive. And you can't live without her.
Now is kind of interesting because I started that song, you know, like maybe 10 years ago, maybe even longer. I started the chord progression. I remember exactly where I was. I was sitting on a bed in a condo in New York, playing my guitar. I had the cape on, maybe the fifth fret. It was super high, and I was strumming. If I don't leave it now, and I had kind of that. And then I lowered the key and kept sort of working on the song as the years went by, not a lot. But then when I sat down to write this group of songs, I revisited it. It was in the list of contenders for this record, and then, but it wasn't quite, it didn't really strike anybody particularly, you know, it wasn't like, oh, that's a keeper, we got to have that. But then Jordan had the idea to turn it into a ballad. She said, just, she completely slowed down the tempo and wrote this little part for it and then represented it. And then it was like, we have to have this on the record now. And it was really, who knew?
And when it hits the papers, the tongues start wagging like it can't be happening.
You know what? I don't have it in me. My voice is tired. What, you don't agree? It's a song that means a lot to me. And when we went to record it, usually I like to overdub, so I'll like to play a song, we'll get the track, I'll maybe play guitar, then I'll sing my vocals and we'll put it together. But Jordan's like, just try playing this and singing it with the guitar. I didn't have any headphones on and I just sang it in a room. And I was in a bad mood, I didn't feel good, I felt like maybe I was coming down with something. I think it was towards the end of the day, I was crabby. I said to Jordan, I don't know if I'm coming down with something, my throat feels scratchy, I just, ugh, I'm mad. I don't want to do this. I don't think I can do this. And she said, well, just try it one more time. And so really I did it for her.
Don't give up yet.
Okay, I won't give up yet.
I appreciate that.
No problem.
Pull up your britches.
That's it. Take a deep breath. Pull up your britches. Before I recorded it, I wouldn't have gone intellectually, I'm mad and I feel like crap and this is a song about addiction and it's really heavy and so this should be perfect. Let's do it. You know, it was more like, I don't feel like it. But of course it does make perfect sense. And that's part of the mystery that just happens in recording and with music and with members of your team and your friends who can push you through something to get to the other side.
You are rolling.
Here we go. One, two, three.
Say if it ever was, it's still in there. You can dig and fill, and never will be full. Trying to get that good again. Your last fifth of Jack, a cigarette, the time you bet the farm before you lost it all. You want that feeling. Back you go against the wind and killing yourself to stop from running out of time. out of me. If there was ever one that could be to you and you and you, a blue sky could be bluer, a whiter shade of white. While you pour it on, you pour it out, you empty everything you might have saved instead for your loneliest night. And back you go against the wind and advice, killing yourself to stop from running out of life. But if I don't leave it now, I will never get out of this place. Baby, believe. Tongues start wagging like it can't be happening. Doctors take it and they take it away. And when they do, you'll find your stand-up every man goes looking for his heroin. It happens every day around.
Bluebird is like considered sort of the heartbeat of the singer-songwriter scene in Nashville. May it be country or Americana or whatever, it's where the songwriters go. So songwriters go there to like play their new songs, and they may not be performers, they may just be mainly songwriters that have publishing deals. And on writer's night, we would drive like 4 or 5 hours to Nashville, go to the Bluebird, play one or two songs, and drive back home same night. Because that was where songwriters were. That's where you like made your stand.
In the Austin night, under vapor lights, you laughed at me, then you took me in. The day of the dead, in a circle we said the names, all on the corner of our hearts.
The first song I ever wrote was one with my sisters called Pollution in the Air. It goes like this. Pollution in the air. What do people care about pollution? It's not another charity. Oh my God.
Yeah,
it was a co-write. Even before that, though, I plunked out a song on piano called, with just one notes, called Didn't They Know the People? Oh. And it didn't make sense, but I was just emulating songs I was hearing.
That's good.
You know, like Peter, Paul, and Mary and Kingston Trio records and stuff like that.
You know all them sweaty boys hanging out at the copper mines. You watch them growing up under the bridge. The river shores,
of Georgia night. I used to lay their sweet bodies out, just waiting on a fishing line. Just like a daddy did when he was a kid in the wilds of Florida. But your daddy's gone. Those boys got roof jacked up, moved on.
Fishtails, I like, the moment I heard it, I was like, I get it, and I want, I see it being this, and I see it being like, you know, driving around listening to Springsteen at night when it's like you feel equal parts, like, free and lonely and that kind of thing. And I was like, vivid, and so it was real easy. So like I didn't hold back. I just like did all the things I wanted to do.
Those boys jacked up, got roof, moved on. Hiding in the stories of drunken men with the kids in tow from the picture show driving over mountain bends. I live in an area that's pretty rural, and I hear a lot of stories from a lot of kids about their families and their parents and their dad, you know, their like problems with addiction and meth and alcohol and everything. You know your daddy's gone, the boys you love got broke, the girls have moved on. Still, you gotta find some goodness somewhere, somehow. I was thinking about these kids growing up and like the loss of innocence and stuff. And I was working on this song. And in the midst of it, I just kind of left it. And then my dad passed away like 10 days before my daughter was born. And it was just like the craziest emotional shift for me. Because it had to do with the innocence of my kid being born, and the, it's not a loss of innocence, but when you lose a parent, well, especially for me, like losing my father, because I'm kind of more masculine, I automatically like jumped into his skin in a way, and like became, tried to take his place in the world for a while, which is a weird place, because he was a really big mixture of a lot of things. For me, on this record especially, there's a lot of songs that I started a long time ago prior to losing my dad and finished after losing my dad, which is like a weird, which is, makes it a hard record for me, you know? Because I don't know what the connection is, but for some reason there were a lot of songs I couldn't finish before. But the reality of losing something and then gaining a daughter at the same time makes you, well, the only thing you can do sometimes is write.
Just like your daddy did when he was a kid in the wilds of Florida, but your daddy's gone. Those boys jacked up, got roof, moved on.
You know, I think a lot of people have that moment where they have to figure out what they want to be when they grow up kind of thing, and I never had that moment. It was never anything else, and my sweet parents really just took me to every lesson I wanted to go to, and which was multiple nights a week at different, you know, towns, and I just wanted to know how everything worked, and I wanted to play everything, and so I didn't think about it. It wasn't like a, maybe I'll do this when I grow up. It's just, you just did it.
Music is because we vibrate as physical beings, and music is vibrations. You know, there's a physiological reality to it, heartbeat, rhythm, all the things that we are as bodies. So it's, you know, body, mind, and spirit. It's intense.
Music was kind of like the thing that I thought, you know, bound people together that were underdogs and kind of cultural rebels. And it was like that rebellion, you know, the thing about rock and roll, you know, rebellion and going against society and authority, and that appealed to me. All of that appealed to me. And I still, like, would like to think of myself as part of that group of people, but, you know, but I've been on a major record label, and, you know, I have a retirement, you know what I mean? I'm, like, stable, and all the things that, like, you don't necessarily get if you're, like, really put your life on the line to question authority in the biggest way. And so I feel like I'm sort of in the middle ground of, like, I feel a kinship to that kind of rebellion, and I still do it, but I'm not suffering for it, you know, in the way that some people are.
Flannery O'Connor has that great quote about fiction being a higher truth, that you can get to certain things that are more true than fact with fiction. And I think music's like that, where you can't even, that's why it's hard to talk about music, you know, because you can't quite place it. It's like a little fairy on the edge of the wood. As soon as you like look for it, it kind of darts away. And I don't know, it's good to preserve some of that.
You could just go to music. I mean, everybody who loves music or loves, even has one favorite song, knows that you could just go to music anytime. I mean, even if you're in prison, you can go to music. or, you know, imprisoned, either bodily imprisoned or imprisoned in your mind or with your illness or whatever it is. So music is just about everything. It really is. And because I'm a big romantic, or at least I used to be more than I am now. Now I'm a little bit more of a realist. It's just a great way to meld all my worlds together. I feel grateful for it. And then to find somebody like Amy to work with for all these years, over 30 years, it's unbelievable.